Beautiful.
Do you also get tempted to say check of the check of the Chinese check-in every time you do the check part?
Nope.
No.
Sean did not grow up with bare naked ladies.
Aw.
Yeah, I was more of a 50 Cent guy.
Yeah, I think of those as being very much, it's one or the other.
It's one or the other. Two sides. I've always said that. Welcome to I'd Buy That for a Dollar, a podcast about inexpensive, common, and underappreciated records that are waiting to be rediscovered. I'm your host, Sean Hartman, and I got to start this one with a confession.
Love to start with a confession.
All right, here we go. I just didn't get a chance to watch this movie, guys. I tried. I did listen to the score a few times, and I quickly crammed as much research as I could into the last, 10-15 minutes, but I think I'm ready to make this work. I watched the trailer, read a few reviews. However, I'm a little confused because I couldn't find any history of the score being released on vinyl. Seems like an interesting later Nicolas Cage performance, but I'm just interested to hear what Peter has to say about it.
I have seen both that Joe that you're referring to, as well as the Joe that we're here to actually talk about, Sean, that is not it.
Oh, are we actually talking about the 1970 John G. Alvinson and Norman Wexler movie starring Peter Boyle?
Indeed we are.
Oh, the one featuring both Jerry Butler and Exuma on the soundtrack?
That's the one.
Well, I've obviously seen that, so I'm ready to go. Let's do this.
Perfect.
I'm co-host Jeremy, and co-host Peter is picking these highly political movies right before the election. So I figured I'd kind of balance things out with a new side gig. Make a little money on the side.
Ooh. Seems our way.
What you got?
You guys know how conservative politicians like to use decidedly unconservative songs at their rallies and stuff?
Yeah, like Ronald Reagan using Born in the USA.
Yeah, so I want to kind of, I'm going to help them make it fit. We're going to kind of rework some of these songs.
The songs from this soundtrack?
Well, this one is not actually on the soundtrack, but the other Hey Joe, I was thinking something like, Hey Joe, where you going without a gun in your hand? Kind of promote guns.
So it's more of a pro-gun anthem now?
Well, yeah, NRA's kind of funding, me doing the rework, so. Yeah.
Sure, you got to go where the money is. No shame in that.
No shame.
Wow, you always find a way, Jeremy. You always find a way to...
This episode brought to you by the NRA.
Oh, no.
Wow. Are you sure you watched this, Sean?
Well, yeah, we're going to be diving into this momentarily here, but I'm going to take a deep breath and say that I am co-host Peter Cook. And guys, I think record collectors are very groovy people.
Yeah, makes sense. It's a pun, right?
That's a pun. I wanted to have some fun before we started talking about this film.
One last bit of fun, and then we start the episode.
Yeah, so if people don't know already, we're talking about the original soundtrack to the 1970 surprise hit film, Joe. The soundtrack was released on Mercury Records, and we'll have plenty to say about the film, but of course we are focusing on the soundtracks here in our opening month of season 6, and I wanted to start with a number by the Iceman himself, Jerry Butler, and the song, Where Are You Going? Side A, track 1.
Where are you going? Tell me what you won't be. You're coming of age, but you're lost on a page no one will see. Oh, is wisdom wasted on the young? Or will the peaceful songs you've sung help to change the world? It's all up to you. Child, all you gotta do is grow up. Little girl, you'll love now and learn now. Life's waiting, it's your turn. Live and to give. And oh, I wonder, where in the world are you going? Will you find a heaven or hell? Will you be wise when there's love in your eyes, or too blind to tell?
Whoa. Yeah, it's a great atmosphere right out of the gate. And I really love those like heavy tremolo guitars. They're like, wah, 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 wah. Very nice.
Yeah, it's a good vibe. It's a good effect. They sound just kind of drippy and just loaded with emotion.
Yeah, that song, it actually bookends both the film and the soundtrack, interestingly enough. It is at the beginning of both the film and the end of the film, as well as on the soundtrack. I actually am not clear on whether the version at the end is the same as the version at the beginning or not. I tried to listen, and they're very close if they are at all different takes.
Oh, yeah, that's interesting that they would do that. I see on soundtracks they'll be like, you know, like a reprise to the theme at the end, like a 1 minute, like, here's the theme again real quick, but not just like, here's the same song over again.
They're identical length, so yeah.
Yeah.
I have a lot of questions about this soundtrack, and there's actually not a whole lot of answers out there readily available about the soundtrack, but I did find some information on the people who wrote that song, as well as several of the songs that appear on the soundtrack. It seems they were written specifically for this film. So, of course, we mentioned that was performed by Jerry Butler, who we have talked about before because we featured an episode on his backing band, the Iceman's Band, several seasons back now.
Yeah, and now we're hearing the Iceman himself.
We're finally hearing the Iceman himself. But it was written by Bobby Scott and Danny Meehan. Bobby Scott was a New York multi-instrumentalist who had come up in the jazz world. He co-wrote the songs A Taste of Honey and He Ain't Heavy, He's My Brother, some big titles.
Yeah, covered many, many times.
Yeah, yeah. And he also, on this film, aside from writing the songs with lyrics, he also composed the score. And I decided not to feature any of the instrumental pieces that he composed while we're talking about the soundtrack today. Originally, I was going to, but I decided to focus on all the vocal songs that appear on the soundtrack.
Yeah, that makes sense. I mean, the score tracks are fun. They're good, if not maybe a little generic and just kind of similar to many other times where there's been like a hippie themed movie. They're like, all right, we need like a kind of hippie pop score. Make it happen. Just kind of write it in a couple days, seemingly.
Exactly. Now, Danny Meehan, the other co-writer of these songs, was a New York-based dancer, singer, and actor who wrote several songs in collaboration with Bobby Scott outside of this. But yeah, he also co-wrote the songs on this album. I'm under the impression, I'm not 100% on this, but I'm under the impression that Bobby Scott was the music writer and Danny Meehan the lyricist. Mm-hmm. Yeah, most of the songs with lyrics were written by them, the exception, of course, being the Exuma cut that we will be getting to shortly here.
Did they do the Dean Michaels song on there as well?
They did, yeah. Yeah, which is
okay.
Very different flavor, and we will play that a little later on as well. I know they seem like they're pretty versatile musicians and songwriters. Little information on Jerry Butler, since it's been over 4 years since we talked about him.
Time for a refresh.
Yeah, just a little quick capsule review of Jerry Butler. Maybe one day we'll do a full dedicated episode to him, but for now we'll just go with the fact that he was an original member of the vocal group The Impressions. He co-wrote their song For Your Precious Love, a huge song. He would also co-write I've Been Loving You Too Long with Otis Redding. He came up in the Chicago scene, but was also heavily linked to Philadelphia and was given the nickname The Iceman by a Philly disc jockey to describe his cool, smooth delivery. He worked a lot with Gamble and Huff, who we've talked about several times, the writing and production team of Gamble and Huff. And he also worked for decades in politics in Illinois as a Cook County Board Commissioner. So he was an entrepreneurial fellow. We talked a lot about him. See our Iceman's Band episode for more information on Jerry Butler, and perhaps more yet to come. Just can't get enough of Jerry Butler, and I'd buy that for a dollar.
Yeah, no shortage of Jerry Butler records out there, especially if you start digging through like $1.45 bins. There's so much Jerry.
He was signed to Mercury Records, and this was released on Mercury Records to coincide with the film, which the film was released July 15th, 1970, directed by John G. Avildsen, one of his earliest films before he went on to international acclaim for films like Rocky and The Karate Kid. We also mentioned him pretty recently on our Saturday Night Fever episode because he was originally hired to direct that picture before filming even began for conceptual disagreements or something along those lines. All right, guys, so this was new to you, this film.
Yeah.
Never heard of it before this.
I'm not surprised. It was a big hit in its day, but it has been lost to time largely.
So I was, I guess, vaguely aware of the film, but only through seeing the soundtrack. I've bought and sold it a couple of times, and, you know, doing the Exuma episode, this soundtrack pops up on his discography on Discogs. So I've, like, seen the cover many times and just kind of always wondered, like, I wonder what this 1970 movie is that has an Exuma song on the soundtrack. I'm kind of curious, but it never went further than that. So I was excited to dive in on this mysterious movie that I knew nothing about aside from that.
Yeah, you just look at the cover and you see the names Jerry Butler and Exuma. All right, cool.
Yep.
You look below that and you see actor Peter Boyle, much younger than you're probably used to seeing him, holding in one hand a shotgun, in the other hand, an American flag, and there is a target with a hippie girl in it. So
yeah, just right off the bat, just so many questions. Like, what is going on with this movie?
You don't know what's going on with this movie.
Yeah.
Well, so unlike the other John G. Avildsen films that we mentioned, those films like Rocky and The Karate Kid having emphasis on the triumph of the underdog, Joe depicts the voice of the mob, the loudest voice, the voice willing to resort to violence, even perhaps eager for violence. Although, you know, it's possible that the character of Joe played by Peter Boyle, likely sees himself as a victim or an underdog. I've seen him described as MAGA long before MAGA, or a precursor to the character Archie Bunker on the television show All in the Family. Apparently, he was an inspiration. Even, you could say, a precursor to the character of Travis Bickle in Taxi Driver.
Mm-hmm.
Peter Boyle, who actually had a small role in Taxi Driver as the character Wizard, he's best known nowadays for portraying the father Frank on Everybody Loves Raymond.
Right, yeah. So yeah, it's weird having that iconic of a role and then seeing a much younger version in a very different character.
So I thought this might actually work. The best way that we could just kind of run through a summary of the film is to actually just do something we don't do too often on the show, and that's read from the back of the jacket. Are you guys game for that?
Let's do it.
Bring it on.
The film opens in a Greenwich Village apartment with Melissa, the daughter of $60,000 a year parents, which adjusted for inflation is around $500,000 in 2024, and her partner Frank, a junkie. A victim of the drug culture, Melissa freaks out on speed and is taken to Bellevue. Her father, Bill Compton, goes to her pad to collect her clothes and encounters her boyfriend. Compton becomes enraged in a heated conversation in which his daughter is accused by Frank of being a whore. In a violent madness, he beats Frank to death. He then stuffs his daughter's clothes in a shopping bag that the junkie boyfriend has just brought back full of drugs. Bill Compton meets Joe in a neighborhood bar in which Bill has stopped to phone the hospital about his daughter's condition. Joe is mouthing off about the world of today, saying that he would like to kill just one of the hippies screwing up the world. Bill Compton remarks that he just did, but then convinces Joe that he was only kidding. When the murder makes headlines, Joe puts the pieces together and tracks down Compton to arrange a meeting. Melissa's father, Bill Compton, thinks that he is in for blackmail, only to find out that this is not what Joe had in mind. Joe admires Compton for ridding the world of a junkie, and he wants to be his friend. A tour of the bars in Joe's life and the bars in Compton's life follows, and both sides of middle-class life are talked about and compared. Melissa finds out that her boyfriend is dead. She runs away from the hospital and goes home, where she overhears her parents talking about the murder. She realizes that her father is responsible and leaves home. Her father and Joe search the village looking for her. They become involved in the hippie world by using Frank's drugs to gain entrance to a party at which they smoke pot and engage in free sex. When they discover that their wallets and drugs have been stolen, they head for a hippie commune in the country in search of the thieves. What follows next is one of the most shocking scenes ever brought to the screen. It's an ending that's sure to leave moviegoers too stunned to move from their seats. I am not making up the plot of this movie.
Yeah, it's a wild ride.
In about an hour and a half, all of that occurs.
Mm-hmm.
So you guys both watched it.
I did. Yeah. I finished it earlier today, actually.
And how did you feel afterwards?
I enjoyed it. I would say I'm going to give it a 3.5 stars on Letterboxd, also known as a Gentleman 7. I thought it was pretty good. I was really turned off by the first few minutes. And then after reading about it later, that was like the general audience reaction. It's like a different movie at the beginning. And Joe, the main character, isn't even in the first few minutes. And it's kind of a bummer. And then it has this weird, like, dark comedy shift. And I was definitely hooked after that, like, shift in the beginning.
Mm-hmm. I have a little more information on that, just as far as how the film unfolds. But I'd be curious, before we get into that and play another song, to see what Jeremy thought of it.
I just skipped ahead to the shocking ending. Not really.
Okay.
I love that you didn't immediately laugh because you thought maybe that happened.
Beautiful. Yeah, I wouldn't put anything past you anymore.
Unfortunately, Jeremy, I originally saw a few clips from this film in a documentary called A Decade Under the Influence about film in the 1970s. They didn't actually include the shocking ending in that. I went back and rewatched the section of that documentary where they talk about Joe, and for some reason I thought they had spoiled it in the film, but I must have gone on YouTube after seeing a couple clips from the ending at years ago now, and seeing what happens at the very end of the film, because I definitely knew when I watched this for the first time in its entirety in the last year, I knew it was coming at the ending, which is unfortunate.
Yeah, a little bit. I was struck by, like, when the shocking ending happens, then the movie just ends. There's, like, no follow-up to what, like, the ramifications are or anything. Should we say what happened?
Spoiler alert. If you haven't already watched the 54-year-old film Joe, spoiler alert, Bill Compton and Joe end up raiding a hippie commune out in the countryside and shooting everyone crashing there, which in the very end of the film, at the very end of that rampage, Bill Compton unknowingly shoots his own daughter, Melissa, who happened to be at the commune.
Right. And then it ends on her being shot and then a freeze frame.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then
shocking. Maybe doesn't have quite as much power today, after, you know, if people have seen any other seemingly shocking or gory movies, but if you really think about what's happening, it's pretty heavy. It's a pretty bleak ending.
Just a little bit.
I found, yeah, the ending is bleak, but I think watching the movie nowadays, the more like troubling part was how like relevant it still feels. Mm-hmm. And how we're just living through another iteration of the wealthy kind of making an uneasy bargain with working class right wing, and targeting people on the left. And
yeah,
it still happens.
This movie in a lot of ways was like, hey, this is kind of a warning of this thing that's happening. It could be dangerous maybe 50 years on or so. Here we are.
It turns out they were right.
Yeah.
Well, you both have raised a couple interesting points that I would like to address, but before I do so, I think we should listen to another song.
Let's do it.
So this is my favorite song on the soundtrack, because how could you go wrong with Exuma?
You can't. You can't do it.
Exuma's debut had just been released on Mercury, his self-titled debut. So featuring him on the soundtrack was the label's way of getting his music out there. Let's listen to You Don't Know What's Going On by Exuma, Side B, Track 3.
You don't know what's going on. You don't know what's going on. You can't make the world go round. You don't know what's going on. You're here today and tomorrow you're gone. When the holy cow is milking and the greenbacks are rolling, you are king and queen in. But when the greenbacks turn brown and you fall down, what you gonna do?
That is one of my favorite Exuma songs. with a, you know, a song from a catalog of many great songs. From what I understand, this movie and having this track featured was like a big part of Exuma being able to have a continued recording career. Makes sense that that kind of adds to the mystique of how Exuma got to become this kind of mythical figure in pop culture around this time.
Yeah.
But yeah. Amazing song.
Yeah. What an odd route for him to gain exposure.
Yeah. And like I said, I'd always been so curious, like, how do you use Exuma on a soundtrack? Like, where does it go? And then watching the movie, I was like, oh, of course they're going to use it during a drug use scene. Mm-hmm. Like, let's use the weird druggy song for the weird druggy scene in the movie.
Yeah. And I like how it's being played over the radio in that scene.
Oh, yeah. Perfect environment. Yeah. And it's got the like lo-fi sound, and it's presented in a different way from a lot of the other tracks that you hear in the soundtrack. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That was when I was watching the film, I think we had pretty recently discussed Exuma on the podcast. I realized that was 2 years ago now, but at the time that
it does feel a lot more recent than that, doesn't it?
Yeah. But at the time that I watched this within the last year, you know, it was relatively recent that we had talked about Exuma, and I initially didn't recognize that it was him. Cause I think we covered his fourth album Snake, not his self-titled debut. So I wasn't familiar with that song, but instantly I was grabbed. I was like, this seems familiar to me. It's just it's such a triumphant sounding song.
Yeah, and I think we talked on that episode too, how Exuma has this handful of songs that feel so close to like they could have just been a huge pop song. He feels like he's got these tracks that should be covered many times and should be much bigger than they were. But his stuff was always a little too weird for that level of mainstream success. And, you know, the comparison I was thinking about too with this song is people could hear that song in the soundtrack and pretty easily either go, oh, that's a just weird druggy song, that's not for me, or be like, man, what was that? That's like a highlight of this soundtrack. I got to hear more of that. I think people were kind of split between these different reads on the movie itself, from what I understand. The audiences seeing this movie in theaters were either coming away being like, hell yeah, Joe's my dude. He speaks for me. I love how racist this guy is. I feel seen. And then, you know, you had younger, more countercultural people that were like, fuck this Joe guy. Like, I want to get a gun and fight Joe.
Yeah, that seems to be the two very polarizing reactions that the audiences.
Yeah, so somehow miraculously everyone thought this movie was for them.
So yeah, the screenplay was written by Norman Wexler, who we also recently talked about on our Saturday Night Fever episode, because he also wrote that. Originally, John G. Avildsen was slated to direct Saturday Night Fever and suggested that Norman Wexler was the right guy for the job. He had obviously worked with him on this picture previously.
Yeah. Also notable for doing Serpico in 1973.
Yeah. I've never seen that.
It's really good. I watched it just a few months ago for the first time, and I enjoyed it much more than I thought I would.
I'll have to check it out. I feel like there's not that many Norman Wexler films out there, so you could pretty quickly catch up on them. There's like a half dozen or so. In doing some research on this film, I found out that the end result of this picture is quite different from what both Avildsen and Wexler originally conceived. Apparently, the original film ran 2.5 hours and was considered... Oof. Yeah. Getting into some Heaven's Gate territory here.
Just another hour and they could have been there.
Yeah. It was considered unwatchable by test audiences. It wasn't even called Joe originally. It was titled The Gap and focused more heavily on the generation divide between the character of Bill Compton, portrayed by Dennis Patrick, and his daughter Melissa, portrayed by a very young Susan Sarandon in her first feature film role. I was surprised seeing her that young in this picture.
Yeah, same.
And the character of Joe, portrayed by Peter Boyle, was a minor character in the 2.5 hour cut. The producers of the film, after I think several failed test screenings, they ended up firing Avildsen. Apparently this guy had a proclivity of getting fired from films. Yeah, they fired director John Avildsen and brought in a young film school graduate named William Sachs to salvage the film. And the first thing he did was scrap the first four reels of the picture, which were all Melissa and her parents in their relationship and no Joe. Sachs deemed this first section of the film boring. So therefore, the finished film starts about 50 minutes into what was originally intended.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And the film kind of feels like that, but it still works. It's kind of a miracle.
Yeah. You're sort of dropped into their world without much context.
Yeah. And like I said, like I was into that. I do like when movies just drop you in without having to explain too many things, you know, show, don't tell. But yeah, the beginning of the movie, I was like, oh, this feels just depressing immediately. Like, I don't know if I'm ready for an hour and 45 minutes of watching these two sad people mess things up. Mm-hmm. And then it just switches. I was like, whoa, is this? I was like, that's such an unusual shift. Like, this is the main character and he wasn't even in the beginning. Like, is this movie just like a mess or are they doing something genius? I just don't know.
Are they doing the psycho switch?
Yeah.
So William Sachs then had Peter Boyle return to record additional dialogue and re-edited the film to increase the focus on the Joe character. He also hacked off 10 minutes at the end of the film in the aftermath of the bloody climax. In these 10 minutes that were hacked off, the characters discuss what had happened. And in removing this, it ensured that audiences were just hit with that shocking ending and then sent back out into the world to think about what they had just watched. According to Sachs, William Sachs, the film doctor who was brought in, original director John G. Avildsen did not want his name on the film because he was mad the producers had taken it away from him. But then as soon as he saw Sachs' recut, he wanted his name back on it. And to his everlasting regret, Sachs declined an offer to share director's credit with Avildsen, choosing instead the vague credit of post-production supervisor because he felt that better reflected his role in the film. So then Avildsen was the one who started getting all the calls for more films when Joe was a surprise hit.
Ugh.
And it was a big hit. It was the 13th biggest film of 1970 and the biggest independent film of that year. It put Canon film production on the map.
Huh.
Yeah, I was surprised to learn that. There was also a dialogue version of the soundtrack released called Joe Speaks, which featured Peter Boyle. Hmm. It featured Peter Boyle's various tirades. If you can imagine having that in your house to sit down and listen to on a regular basis. Like,
yeah. So the people who like enjoyed the movie for the racist parts and bought the soundtrack were like, well, not racist enough.
Yeah. So they had to,
I need some xenophobic rants on here and then I can really get down.
Yeah. It's wild. So we're listening to the hippie version of the soundtrack
for the streets.
Yeah, exactly. That blew my mind to learn that there were multiple versions of the soundtrack released for this picture.
I had read that whole thing with Sachs and his complaint about not getting the credit and kind of missing out on that. And I was like, is this guy like an unsung hero? Like, what else has he done? And his filmography is nothing. Like, I'd heard of literally no other movie he'd been a part of. Apparently he did have like a history of kind of saving films like this though. Like, he was the guy the industry would call in, be like, hey, can you make this movie a hit or at least like make us not lose money real quick? And he just like had a knack for doing that somehow.
That was his thing. He's like Harvey Keitel, the wolf in Pulp Fiction.
Right.
Come in to save the day. I also learned that the role of Joe was originally going to be portrayed by legendary tough guy actor Lawrence Tierney, known today for playing a different Joe, crime boss Joe Cabot, in Quentin Tarantino's Reservoir Dogs, as well as Elaine Bennis's father, Alton Bennis, on Seinfeld. Do you guys remember him on Seinfeld?
Yeah. He was supposed to be on more episodes, but the actor just unnerved the crew so much that they decided never to write him into an episode again.
Yep. Oh my God. That's Lawrence Tierney for you.
Yeah. legendary tough guy.
Yeah, yeah. On screen and off. If you watch extras on the various Reservoir Dogs DVDs, they have tons of stories of him just being an absolute terror to work mm-hmm. with. And that was the same case here. Threatening and weird behavior ended up ensuring that they let go of him before filming started, just a few days before filming of Joe started. And I think it would have been a very different performance than what Peter Boyle was able to bring to the table.
Because he adds just enough of a little bit of comedy in here. Like, this is definitely a black comedy in that there's a little bit of humor, but it's kind of buried, and there's a little bit of satire, but maybe not as explored as I would like it to be. But yeah, Peter Boyle's definitely got some magic in this performance. I can understand why people gravitated towards his performance.
Yeah, for better or worse, he humanizes Joe.
Yeah. Yeah, that is one of the interesting things this film achieves, is like, I don't like this guy and I can't co-sign anything he's doing, but there's something human and fascinating and not entirely malevolent about him.
And this is effectively his debut lead performance. He had worked in traveling theater and joined the Second City Ensemble in Chicago in the late 1960s. He had appeared in a few small film roles prior to this, but this is his debut. This is his arrival, and it's a riveting performance. You would think he is this horrible homicidal racist, and if you know anything about Peter Boyle, he was a staunch leftist, nearly a pacifist.
Right.
His Everybody Loves Raymond co-star Patricia Heaton, who's a vocal conservative in Hollywood, she referred to Boyle on the set as a pinko flag burning commie, and Peter Boyle was horrified by the positive response from certain audience members to his portrayal of Joe, who failed to see the satire in his portrayal.
Yeah,
like walking down the street and just having all the construction workers being like, hell yeah, man, it's about time someone said the shit you're saying.
Yeah, like, constantly.
That would just be a weird place to occupy as like a previously non-famous liberal.
Yeah. He vowed to not appear in any other film or TV role which glorified violence, including turning down the role of Popeye Doyle in The French Connection the following year, a role that earned Gene Hackman the Oscar for Best Actor, which I will say, that's a great film, great performance by Gene Hackman, but I think Peter Boyle could have also pulled off that role.
Yeah, I mean, my first thought was like, oh, well, that's like such a Gene Hackman role, you can't possibly replace it. But then you see this, the more you think about it, it's like, yeah, Peter Boyle, we could have done it. I agree.
Mm-hmm. There were exceptions to this vow he took, of course, including he appeared a few years later, as we mentioned, as Wizard in Taxi Driver, a very violent film. So mm-hmm. he didn't hold entirely true to that. But yeah, I don't think he ever quite portrayed anyone this volatile ever again.
Until Everybody Loves Raymond, the most violent sitcom.
Well, speaking of the Joe character, I think it's about time we listen to his theme song that was written by Bobby Scott and Danny Meehan for this film and recorded by a guy named Dean Michaels, who I could find nothing about this guy.
Same.
Yeah, this is his only credit on Discogs.
The back of the jacket describes him as an up-and-coming talent in the film and record world, but that didn't help me out any. I don't know whatever happened to this guy. So it's a mystery. If anyone knows out there, if you're Dean Michaels, email us at idbuythatpodcast@gmail.com and tell us what you've been up to over the last 54 years. But yeah, let's go ahead and listen to, I think this is, I'll just say up front, I think this being written for the film is an indication that dark comedy, that satire is intended.
Yeah, definitely.
Hey Joe by Dean Michaels, side B, track one.
Hey Joe, don't it make you wanna go to war once more? Hey Joe, Why the devil did we go to war before? What the hell for? I saw a fella selling junk to children. He gets nervous every time I pass, 'cause he knows that if I catch him, I'm gonna bust his head and kick his fat. Hey Joe, don't it make you wanna go to war once more? Hey Joe, why the devil did we go to war before? What the hell for? 3 nights a week I work until 7. Gotta make me some overtime. When you got a wife and some children, how in the hell can you save a goddamn dime? Hey Joe, don't it make you wanna go to war once more? Hey Joe, why the devil did we go to war before? What the hell for? People demonstrate against my country, looking for an easy buck. But if they want my contribution, well, they can go take a flying.
No, we aren't trying to clean things up over here. I'd buy that for a dollar. That bleep is on the record on that song. They cut out the profanity, even though the film is very vulgar. And I have to imagine the Joe Speaks album. Are they cutting out the profanity on that? I don't know. I haven't listened to it.
Yeah, I'm very curious what clips were used from the dialogue.
I tried to look into who Dean Michaels was as well, because listening to this, I was having a hard time gauging if it was satire or if they like tricked someone who had written this song earnestly into including it on the soundtrack. So it was a little bit riding that line where I was having a hard time telling, honestly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's telling the fact that it was written by Bobby Scott and Danny Meehan.
Yeah, once I knew that, I was like, oh, yeah, okay.
But yeah, I did wonder, I'm like, is this a pseudonym for someone else who didn't want to, you know, like they say so little else about him and there's nothing out there. So it makes me wonder. It was released as a single, too, on Mercury. So
yeah. With a song called Wash Woman that I couldn't find.
Yeah, I saw that too. And that was, I'm glad that we all tried going and finding anything about this guy and all came up empty. Yeah, I will be curious if maybe we have a researcher out there who can dig deeper and find out whatever came of Dean Michaels. Well, Sean, we turn to you at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And ask if you could find recommended similar albums to this very unique soundtrack.
Well, thankfully, this was the time for countercultural movies and music. So, yes, I was able to find 3 similar bargain bin friendly albums and soundtracks, which are: first one, The Strawberry Statement from 1970. Another one where I've not seen the movie, but I've bought and sold and listened to the soundtrack multiple times. Either of you guys familiar with that soundtrack or movie?
I'm not. No.
The soundtrack is cool. It's mostly like Neil Young, CSNY related stuff. Thunderclap Newman is on it as well. Buffy St. Marie.
Huh.
Fun record. You can find it for cheap.
Interesting.
Maybe the movie's good. I don't know. Maybe we'll feature that soundtrack later and then I'll be able to watch the movie and have a good reason to see it. Next recommendation, another 1970 movie, Brewster McCloud.
That's one I've never seen either.
Same.
Same. The soundtrack is great though. It's got some Mary Clayton songs on it, Gene Page Orchestra. Kind of a very similar vibe to the soundtrack to this film, actually.
Yeah, I think I need to at some point find out what Brewster McCloud is.
All right, last recommendation, a much more famous movie that I'm sure at least Peter has seen, 1969's classic Easy Rider.
I have seen that one.
Another soundtrack that you find all over the place.
Yeah.
I have also seen that one, Sean. Thanks.
Nice. All three of us. I don't remember any of it. It was a long time ago that I watched it, but I have watched it.
Yeah, it's been over 20 years since I watched the entire film, but yeah, it's a great soundtrack. Since we're on the topic of Easy Rider, this follows in the footsteps of that film. You know, this is in the era that they call New Hollywood, the late 60s through the 70s, which, funny enough, I think in a lot of historical terms is considered to end when you get to Michael Cimino's Heaven's Gate. This is the era.
Yes. Heaven's Gate was often blamed for ending the New Hollywood era.
And that's an era where the Hays Code had been lifted in the late 1960s, where films were very much like restricted from what they could portray in them. And yeah, just more visionary filmmakers were able to start making films with much grittier content. You had Bonnie and Clyde, yeah. Easy Rider, Joe, things like A Clockwork Orange, Straw Dogs, The French Connection.
People were getting nasty on film again. The Hays Code was, ratified in 32 and then enforced in 35, I believe. I looked this up fairly recently. So yeah, a huge chunk of time where there was a lot of stuff that just could not be portrayed in Hollywood on film.
Yeah, and I would say, you know, yeah, when coming out of the Hays Code era, Joe, while it's not particularly graphic in its violence, it was done on a very low budget. I don't think they had the ability to really have much special effects. It's for the climactic rampage is a very blood-free rampage. It's not like Straw Dogs and Sam Peckinpah. But
Right.
The initial killing is strange as well, where they do like a shaky camera thing to try and make it like feel more violent.
Yeah, when Bill Compton is killing junkie boyfriend Frank.
Yeah, he's like bashing his head against the wall, but you know, they couldn't make it look that crazy, so they kind of shake the camera around to give it.
I thought it was a cool effect, especially because they only did those like experimental film techniques like twice, like very sparingly. So I thought it had a nice impact to it.
Yeah, that was, yeah.
It's really funny. I almost featured The Expiration of Frank by Bobby Scott, the score for that scene, as one of our cuts, because I thought we've previously talked about experimental music working really well in the context of a film score, where it's, yeah. And that one gets pretty out there, but it really matches what you're seeing in that scene. But ultimately, I thought we should stick with the vocal cuts. I did want to just point out, if you were looking at this not knowing what it was, and the titles on side two, I thought you could think that it was a hip hop album. Hey Joe, Compton's Hangout, You Don't Know What's Going On, It's a Crock, When in Rome, Send the Hippies to Hell, Where Are You Going?
Yeah, It's a Crock sounds like a lost Run DMC song.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't have much more to say. This is, you will see this out there. It was a popular film, popular soundtrack. If I do see the Joe Speaks, I'm going to pick it up. It's these are always cheap. They are not fetching much money. The first time I ever looked for this, I found it in a record store. I think I found it at RPM Records in Traverse City. $6, I believe.
It's a good record store.
Well, how are you sending us off, Peter?
Well, I thought, let's give the Iceman one more song on this episode. And they give him quite the moment on the soundtrack. I don't know if they asked him to fill out a side or what, because they give him an 11 minute and 25 second cut that's featured in about, I don't know, a minute at most of the film.
Yeah, he really took the title of the song literally with this
one. You can fly. Yeah. You can fly, yeah. This has a sick drum break in it. I did something I haven't really tried before, because I was curious if this was the Iceman's band. backing Jerry Butler on these tracks. They were with him around this time, but given that these seemed to be sort of special circumstances under which these songs were being recorded, I wasn't sure if maybe they had just used any old session players for it, if he had his Iceman's band with him. So I reached out to former Iceman's band member, Robert Boogie Bowles, and he responded to me.
Amazing.
What'd he say?
I reached out asking if he remembered recording these songs with Jerry Butler for the soundtrack, just because there was so little information on how the soundtrack came together. And I realized in his response that I was asking him if he remembers a day of work from 54 years ago. he said, "Hi, Peter, thanks for your interest in my work. I worked for Jerry for 7 years as a guitarist, arranger, producer, and band leader, but I do not recall working on that project. It's good to hear from you." And so I just said, you know, thank you. There's so little information out there. So I was just curious. And, you know, he said, sure thing, Peter. We did a lot of things back in the day. Could have been us. Big fun. Miss those guys. I mean, this is a guy who he worked for Smokey Robinson for years. He recorded the guitar parts for songs like I Will Survive by Gloria Gaynor and mm-hmm. If I Can't Have You by Yvonne Elliman. It was like asking him if he remembered a single day of work 54 years ago. Yeah. So not clear on whether... He's done a lot. It was very, very cool of him to respond. So thank you, Bob. I think he goes by Bob. Bob Boogie Bowles.
Very cool.
So yeah, sick drum break on this track though. So let's get out of here on You Can Fly by Jerry Butler. Thank you for listening to I'd Buy That for a Dollar. My name is Peter Cook.
I'm Jeremy Ruggles.
And I'm Sean Hartman.
Side A, track 3.
Everybody's hanging in there. Times are rough, I know, 'cause I've been there. But the seeds of love are sown and grown in the sun, and there's enough for everyone. Sky. And you can fly, get in high. Now, why don't you listen to me? The winds of change have blown the seeds all over the ground. And any day now when the little seeds have grown, there'll be enough to go around, yeah, to go around. Shooting everybody through the breeze. You got your eye.